José, are you online? Are you with us? Can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you very well, loud and clear, Mathieu.
Welcome back. You were sitting right here beside me on day one, but you had to go back to Geneva. So I missed you, José, but I'm glad that you are also back for this panel discussion.
Of course. Yeah, I'm sorry I cannot be in Davos for the 3 days, but the opening was great. I hope the conclusion will be even greater. So to conclude this this 3 days discussion, of course, we have to talk a little bit of about money, how we attract investment in space, and specifically what's the view that investors have to space investments with this particular concern about cybersecurity. Investing in space is already something very challenging for VCs and private equity investors, because space is capital intensive. It requires a lot of investment before the first revenues can be seen. They come always later. So from this respect, space often doesn't check all the boxes that venture capital investors would like to check before they start investing. The ratios are not there in terms of timing and capital. So it's already a difficult domain to invest in space. Now, if you factor in the threat for the cybersecurity threats in the equation, it becomes even worse. Because cybersecurity, or let's say cyber threats, can have an impact on the service that these companies are willing to provide. It could be denial of service, or it could be simply a spoofing of data, which is even worse. And it can actually have an impact on the infrastructure, because by hacking a satellite, you can actually destroy a whole constellation by this Kessler syndrome. So these are this is the additional complication that cyber threats bring to space. And we're going to be discussing this with our panel this afternoon. And for this, we have invited five persons who are all involved in investment in space. We have Ronald van der Breggen from Route 206. We have Patrick Nicolet from Linebreak Capital. We'll have Mathieu Koss from Airbus Ventures. We'll have Raphael Roettgen from E2MC and Augustin Blanchard from Ace Capital. So, guys, welcome. You each have, let's say, 30 seconds to introduce yourself before we start. So let's start in the order I said. Ronald?
Sure. Hello, everybody, and thank you for having me on the panel. Like José said, I'm a consultant. And through my company, I help companies bring their products to market and developing commercial strategies. I sometimes also help them creating new opportunities and entering new markets. Before that, I was involved with LEOSAT, where I did the commercial rollout, a low Earth orbit satellite constellation focusing on enterprise and government. And through this company, I've come to really appreciate security as a business opportunity for satellite operators and investors. While we've been able to sign up lots of customers pre-launch, ultimately the company was not able to launch itself. It ran out of runway before we had liftoff, so to speak, and that is a bad thing both in business as well as aviation. Before that, I was with SES, where I had the opportunity to work with customers and staff across the globe, and was involved with the O3B project. And prior to that, I was with KPN rolling out fiber infrastructure throughout Europe, connecting 50 cities in 13 countries in a cooperation with Quest out of Denver, Colorado, which by this time I think are called CenturyLink or Lumen. They've gone through some name changes. To wrap this up, I'm not an engineer as many of the speakers were before me. I come from the commercial side of things, and while I've worked with engineers plenty, if not almost all the time, I have some opposing views every now and again, which may come trickle through during this conversation. And I apologize in advance, but you know, sometimes it sparks up the discussion, which is not a bad thing either. So with that, back to you, José.
Yeah, thank you, Ronald. Patrick?
Yep. Hello, José. Good to see you again. I'll be brief. I presented in the first day. I'm on the cybersecurity side. So my investment focus is on distributed and decentralized architecture. And through CYSAT, of course, we have an exposure to the space industry. But again, my focus, my contribution on this discussion, and again, very pleased to be with you again and with the colleagues here, will be on the cybersecurity part.
Thanks a lot, Patrick. Matt?
Hi there. So I'm Matt Kost, partner at Airbus Ventures. I'm leading the EMEA region. Airbus Ventures is a global multi-LP early stage deep tech venture capital firm. And as part of our mandate, we invest in technology that we believe will change or disrupt the vertical angle. And at the top of it, obviously, you've got the world of space. So space is clearly part of it, cyber as well as frontier tech, but we'll come back on that.
Thank you, Matt. Raphael?
Yes, hi, I'm Raphael. Thank you, Mathieu and José, for inviting me to this panel. I'm the founder and managing partner of E2MC Ventures, which is a global early stage venture capital firm that's only focused on investing in space companies. I also try to educate people on space. For example, I recently published a book on the space economy. I host something called the Space Business Podcast, and I teach at a couple of universities, including the International Space University.
Thank you. And eventually, and finally, sorry, Augustin.
Thank you. Thank you, José. And I'm delighted to be here on this panel today. I'm Augustin Blanchard, and I'm a partner at Ace Capital Partners. We operate as a venture growth equity fund out of France. We invest in cybersecurity companies across Europe through Series A, B, or C, and this is what we do: cybersecurity investing. And we recently invested in a space company called Preligent, and doing some artificial intelligence tool to apply to satellite imagery.
Thank you very much. Thank you all. So let's get started. Let me start with Patrick. Without going into the all the consequences of a cyber attack, we've seen throughout the conference that in order to be properly prepared for an attack, for an event, there's a lot of preparation in the early phase, even in the installation of the company. So this means additional investment, it means additional expenses. So how do you deal with that from an investor's perspective, and how does that affect your investor's decision?
I think, yeah, thank you, José. Yes, this is a cost of doing business that nobody can escape right now. I've tried an estimate, let's say, if in the space you would spend about 6.7% of your revenue on your IT system, 10% of it should be allocated to cybersecurity, and I think it has to be part of the risk map. The point is always the same with risk, is that my philosophy when I look at this is that the incident is certain, so unfortunately, the question is when, and then how do you respond? How can you delay as much as possible the occurrence? Where is money spent there? Number one. Number two is, once the incident occurs, what is your capability to respond and contain? Because I think containment is always not something that is advocated a lot, but I think very important from an operational perspective. You lose something, but you don't lose everything. And then the last part is, do you understand your value chain? So which part really needs to be protected, and where do you put your money? If you don't do that, On top, you have some regulatory requirements. A lot of the space company are considered, notably in Europe, with the NIS directive as critical operations. Iron is a case, for instance. And then you have a regulatory requirement to take action and propose to your cybersecurity authority of your country the measures that you have taken to protect your critical systems. So I think it's an important part that you have to look at. But again, not just a blend spent on element of security to have a tick in the box, but really understanding AU threat, the value of your data, and what have you taken in the operational context that I just described.
Well, thank you, Patrick. Now a question, to all of you, but maybe more to Raphael, Augustin, Matt, who are involved directly with startups. New space, we're talking about new space a lot, and we know that new space means the faster and cheaper approach to building satellite infrastructure. That means subcontracting. You subcontract the manufacturing, you subcontract the operations, you use components off the shelf. All these are vulnerabilities potentially. So any particular view on this? Who wants to take it first?
Let me start the answer and then happy to get here. Yours, Augustin, Raphael. To me, as you say, I mean, space is growing. We see lots of startups coming in. They are focusing on where they are good at, I mean, their core brick of technology. But this core brick is not delivering value till it's embedded into a much larger system, infrastructure to reach space, the satellite, the payload, the ground stations, etc. So when you are designing your payload, your satellite, or the bit of the value you're working on, you can be sure that in current use of space stuffs, it's to transit data for Earth observation, communication, navigation. So it's all about data. And what's obvious is that when you think data, you think cyber and surface of attack. Here, while increasing it. My point is one, we cannot think about a space-based system that will ultimately acquire, compute, or transmit data without thinking cyber. So the point is, there is no way to design and for venture capitalists to fund a startup dealing with a space-based asset without having this cyber culture. So to answer your point, it's not because it's low cost that cyber is out of it. Cyber is a must and will become, I believe, even more critical in the future as we see more and more users at the end of the value chain relying on the space-based infrastructure, whatever, to play on their apps on their smartphone, to navigate their car, to go for mountaineering and locate themselves in the GPS or GNSS systems. So to me, low cost cannot mean less cyber, I would say, attention.
Yeah, I'd fully agree with Mathieu. And some of this data is, like Mathieu said, the business in the space economy is substantially about data at this point in time. And we have some other things which are commencing now, like space manufacturing, which are more about atoms than photons and radio waves. But it's substantially about data right now. And some of that data is very critical, right? Mathieu already referenced the navigational data. And we all know the problems that, you know, spoofing that can bring for various critical industries. Now, this part we're discussing here, I'd call it like the defensive element of the cybersecurity in space. You know, I hope we're going to also discuss the offensive part for us as venture capitalists, which is that space can be a solution to some of these problems.
Augustin, you want to add a few words to this?
Yeah. Thank you, José. The way we see it at ACE, we see satellite as connected objects, basically. And the way we approach cybersecurity of connected objects is to first secure the access or bar the access to the connected object through encrypted chipsets. But we also see a great value in securing the fact that source code of softwares and onboarded softwares are flawless. And we have means to do just that.
Thank you. Anyone wants to add something to that?
Well, the only thing I'd like to comment, José, is that if the baseline that we're departing here from is everything should be about, you know, being smarter, being more low cost, being more efficient in the build and design, I think there's a good argument against that being a valid baseline. At the end of the day, what it should be about is about developing services that can deliver real value to, you know, be it companies, be it consumers, be it government. And in speaking with customers, as I have over the past couple of years, if you bring real value to them, and we can go into that later as to what that could be, but security certainly is part of that, then low cost is not really an issue. People are perfectly fine paying a premium over all the alternatives out there if you deliver value, and be it in terms of security or low latency or whatever it may be for them. It's so, again, starting point low cost is great. If you can do it, by all means, go for it. I think the real point of departure is creating something of true value.
Okay. Let's move for a moment to something highly specific, and then I'm turning to Matt here. Airbus Ventures just participated in a significant Series B, 75 million euros, to fund ISAR Aerospace and a launchers company. Implicitly in all the discussions we've had during the conference and now in the early stage of this panel, we've always been thinking about space infrastructure. And no one has ever spoken about launchers. And as we all know, without launchers, there's no space infra. So, and launchers, they can be hacked. I mean, I remember I was involved at CNES in very early stage of Ariane 4. And we had at least one accident where we're not entirely sure that this was an accident and not something which was intentionally done to the launcher. So how do you deal with the cyber threats on launchers, which presumably happens more at the manufacturing phase and development phase? Matt?
Yeah, thank you, José, for the question. It's a very good point. So just for the audience, we are investor in ISAR Aerospace, based out of Munich, Germany, but as well Astra Space in the US and Spin Launch for the next of the launching concepts. So it's a very good point. And here I see several elements. First, protecting the asset, meaning the system that will help ISAR here to design its rocket, to design its equilibrium and the mix of various propellants, is something that we are very careful and we clearly look at it. When the company started, it was just, I mean, they are doing design and they are doing their code and this was just about it. Now we are pushing a lot of, I mean, we're injecting a lot of effort and pushing the management to secure its IT system. Secure its IT system on the, I would say, design side, but as well on the manufacturing side. So obviously ISAR is not the best cybersec company to deal with IoT on the shop floor. We got experts for that, so they are not doing that alone. But with much more 3D printing, much more IoT in their factories, much more connected systems, cyber, or we say cybersec to protect the asset, is clearly part of the conversation we are having up to the board level. Then we'll talk, when we talk systems onboarded onto the rocket, meaning the electronics, the software, same approach. We are designing, I mean, ISAR is designing a system, having in mind that hacking happens, and it's not something for the 22nd century. What I believe the difference can be, but happy to get your views here from the panel, is that there is a matter of generations. You look at the age of the team, ISAR, working on the manufacturing and the design side of things, they are much younger. I think they are much, maybe not prepared, but used to deal or to understand this risk compared with me. I'm a bit older. And when I was, I mean, at school, I did not have an iPhone in my hand. I mean, obviously, I start my work life with a computer, But hacking and cyber risk were not in our head in everything we were doing. I think that when you are working as an engineer and you're 27 in a design office at ISAR, you do have cybersec and hacking much more embedded into your DNA and the way you're looking at a system. So I don't know, maybe Patrick, you saw that through your various professional life between the various steps of your career dealing with system IT and cybersec. But this is something I see. And so to answer your point, José, yes, cyber is something we are looking at from the early design phase to the software embedded into the rocket, down to the manufacturing area of a company like ISAR.
No, Mathieu, you're right. You take Moore's law, it's all about performance and cost.
Correct.
This is the base of IT. It's Moore's law. So it's security has never been. And then you end up with Spectre and Meltdown. Nothing specific to Intel, but in general, that has not been. And I fully concur when I tried to introduce application security in application design 5 years ago. People were thinking, no, it's an additional cost. And today, to the point of Ronald, because you would like, you call for a contentious view, it's not, cybersecurity is not an added value for the client. I mean, you must have it. It's a cost of doing business. It's not an added value. If we could do without it, we would, because frankly, why add all this complexity if we could avoid it? Unfortunately, we cannot. And last year I've shown in the US how aggressive it is. And so, but it remains a cost of doing business. So we really have to look at it this way. And I would not present it to a client that it's a value added in any way, all the more that it is embedded in the infrastructure, and infrastructure is always a cost player as well. So, but yes.
Yeah, interesting. So yeah, it seems that the whole chain of the whole construction and setup of the company is important. To focus maybe more on the final subject, which is a provision of a service and a collection of revenues. Space infrastructure is subject to data spoofing. We've mentioned that. A denial of service, which is something that can happen to any company, but then potentially the complete destruction of the infrastructure. So these are really specific in my view. So is there any particular approach? Do you have any way of measuring these risks, and how do you deal with it? This is really a question to all of you.
Can I add, Jose, I really curious to hear Raphael about what he called the offensive part, which is the contribution of space to cyber, the defense of cyber threats, if you don't mind.
But that's something we're going to be discussing later, but that's fine.
Okay. that we forget.
So, anyone taking this question, the tricky question, an investor will invest in something which could potentially be destroyed entirely by an attack, or let's say incur some significant denial of service.
Well, José, if you put the question like that, it makes it very unappealing to make any investment in space. So again, that is that is a question that makes it difficult to answer in the positive. The only way that I can comment on that, and please others chime in if you have other views on that, is that in the discussions that we've had, for instance, what comes to mind is the discussions we had with the U.S. government. And for clarity, I did not have those discussions with them. I have the wrong passport, but my colleague in the U.S. did that, and he had some security clearances allowing him to speak about more topics than just the weather, so to speak. What became very clear very quickly is that the need to help combat the cybersecurity issues that, for instance, these branches are facing they are more interested in discussing the opportunities that space can bring and the investments in space, what investments in space could yield, than the potential threats that they might find themselves into in putting all that money in space and then run the risk of it not working out, so to speak. So the desire to get problems solved outweighs the fear of potentially doing something that, that might backfire. And in that context, we've had very productive discussions. And we've been offered and have offered multiple paths through that challenge that you just described.
Okay, since you're speaking, then keep the microphone, Ronald. As you said in your presentation, you've been with CYSAT. CYSAT was a precursor of these large constellations for broadband connectivity. Unfortunately, and this is a good example, I mean, it failed to raise the money. It was less lucky than the SpaceX one, Web or Telesat, or let's say Lightspeed. But still, you're promoting security. I mean, that's where Patrick was challenging you. You're promoting security as a business opportunity. Can you further elaborate on this?
Yeah, I'm not so sure if Petra was challenging me on that, but certainly there are other opportunities in space other than security. And in a large part, it is based on the fact that right now, everything telecom related in space seems to be very much focused on broadband. And broadband is a very gateway based system. And during this conference, we've seen that gateways are, a vulnerability of any end-to-end service where they are an integral part of offering that service. So topology matters. If you are able to get data from a rooftop and then using lasers in space to hop that data over from one satellite to another and then land it on the rooftop of the destination and in that way terminate that circuit in a way that completely bypasses anything terrestrial and gateways, you have just reduced the threat surface enormously simply because there's no way for people to access that data on the ground, other than, of course, going up and coming down, which you always have to do. But then being in LEO and having satellites in view 7 minutes at a time, and when you have multiple in view, you can randomly change satellites in making these connections to the rooftop, so to speak. You now have continue to reduce that risk that threat surface, and so where if you think about security, it sometimes all seems to be about inventing the latest and newest encryption technology. Topology and offering security on the lowest level of, if you want, the OSI model, which is the physical infrastructure, is of enormous importance, and it is in this context where the current constellations that we see with their gateway-based topology have a challenge. And so being able to offer security in the way that I just described from rooftop to rooftop is a service where customers are willing to pay a premium for. Everybody has 2 or 3% of its data that they consider to be super sensitive. Whether you're in the potato business or in the high-tech business, every business has that. That's certainly something that trickled through from the conversations we've had. And adding that all together will fill any telecom constellation 10 times over and more. So again, I think this is a fantastic opportunity, and it certainly resonated. And it's a very different one than broadband. And, there's more out there, but security on the offensive side, as it was mentioned, is definitely an opportunity for space. But not all constellations are created such that they're going to be able to have a relevant offering there.
Okay. Thank you, Ronald. Okay, now let's move a little bit down back to Earth. In other words, let's rather than looking at the cybersecurity that space systems offer, let's discuss a little bit the kind of additional security on Earth for every system that potentially space technology can offer. And let me start with Raphael, question for you. Personally, I see free space optics as the future of telecommunication. I mean, it offers the same capability of fiber, except much faster, with no limitation on distance and plenty of additional capabilities and a security dimension. Can you elaborate on free space optics?
Yeah, I'm so happy to ask. I mean, at E2MC, we love optical communications, and we're probably not the only ones here on this panel who think it's, like you said, it's the future of telecommunications. You alluded to some of the advantages already, but just to name a few, it's basically much, much higher data rates than radio frequency, like magnitudes higher, I think over 2 magnitudes higher data rates than radio frequency. It's basically not regulated, right? Because, I mean, it doesn't need to be, because there's almost no interference, even if you cross the beams. Right. And the beams are much, much tighter, right? Which brings us back to our topic at hand here of cybersecurity. It's just much harder to interfere with these. And I think that's the reason that so many constellations are now, you know, trying to integrate at least optical inter-satellite links, right? And then some people are even thinking about links back to Earth, which are a little bit more complicated, which I can come back to in a minute. But I mean, look, SpaceX Starlink, as is widely known, is already has some optical terminals flying on its latest generation Starlink satellites. And then notably talking about security. So all of these constellation projects, for example, you have out of the US military, Blackjack or the transport layer Tranche Zero, I'm pretty sure both of them are using optical inter-satellite links. And I think that's telling us something. And there's a number of companies playing in this already, some traditional ones very well known in Germany, CYSAT and Mynaric. And then you have a few players in the US like SA Photonics and a company we're invested in, Skyloom. So we're very, very bullish on that. We think it just brings a lot of advantages.
And can you be more specific? You mentioned Mynaric and CYSAT, but that is existing companies. But is that driving some specific investments of yours and you'd be prepared to share with us?
Yeah, so we have a small investment in a US-based company called Skyloom, which is doing basically optical terminals. So they're working on optical terminals both for inter-satellite links, so LEO to LEO. And by the way, I mean, a lot of people rightly think this is a very difficult problem, right? Because one, the positive side of the tighter beam is the higher security, right? The negative side is you need very good pointing mechanisms, right? But for example, Skyloom's terminal, now off the top of my head, it's like 10 pounds. It uses very reasonable power, I think like 25 watts, and you can connect over thousands of kilometers. This is obviously LEO to LEO. They're also working on LEO to GEO, which they want to build up a data relay, basically optical links. And they're working on LEO back to the ground, which is slightly more complicated because you have some atmospheric effects without going into too much detail, like scintillation, which makes this more complicated, but it's also solvable.
And is anyone else interested in this kind of investments and doing one that you're prepared to share with us?
Yeah, we at Airbus Ventures invested in a company called Transcelestial, based out of Singapore, doing optical communication, 1 to 10G models, very much active on Earth communication on the ground, but with a clear plan to, as we said, to hop the technology into space. Because as mentioned by Raphael, I truly believe that optical-based communication in space offers great, great opportunities for cyber, but plenty of other elements like bandwidth, stability, etc. So yeah, optical to me seems very, very important. And by the way, when you look at the large corporates, I mean, I'm having conversation with the Airbus corporate teams, and they do have several projects around free space optical communication in the US and in Europe. So it's a hot topic for startups coming in with low cost, high performance solutions, but very critical topic for large corporates who do have strong space-based infrastructure operating today, but they want to maintain their position. So lots of work done here as well.
Interesting. And I'm glad to hear that you're considering, ground-to-ground free space as part of the same game. So it's not strictly space, but it's so close to what's being done from in LEO to LEO, with some additional complications with the atmosphere, of course. But so there's another company in the US, the name escapes, the one run by Matsumori. which is doing ground to space and ground to ground.
You're referring to BridgeSat, Jose.
BridgeSat, yes, exactly. BridgeSat or BridgeCom.
BridgeCom, actually. BridgeCom. Yeah, you're right.
BridgeCom. Yeah. So this is not something that you guys are looking at specifically. I mean, not this one, but this kind of companies. Obviously, Airbus, you are with this. Singapore.
Yeah, Francelecior. Well, you are right, José, that, I mean, there are in-space communication, inter-satellite link, and tomorrow maybe up to the moon or to Mars or wherever. You do have some ground communication infrastructure, the one we know starting with optical fibers. But to me, tomorrow, one network in space will not take over what's happening on the ground and vice versa. We'll have to set up a smart, and I don't know exactly what that means, but a smart mix of routes in space, on Earth, and from and to space. And the way space business is evolving, I mean, obviously fueled with venture capitalist money, but beyond that, the way space infrastructure is growing will clearly be part of the way we manipulate data, meaning store, compute, transmit. And the both infrastructure will have to be somehow interlinked to offer the best of speed, cost, and security to basically serve and deliver the value that we were referring to a few minutes ago to the end user, being a country, being an individual, or a corporate.
Okay. Well, thank you for this. Now let's move on to something slightly different. Momentous. And there will be two rounds of questions around Momentous. The first one is going to be for Augustin, and the other is going to be for all of you. Momentous, let me remind for the audience, it's a company which has developed an orbital transfer vehicle. Vigoride, which will take satellites from one orbit to the other. This company is going to be SPAC'd. I mean, it's going to be merged into a Stable Road Acquisition Corporation, which is one of these newly established SPACs. The problem in going public for a company like that is that the principal investor and the founder of the company, Mikhail Kukurich, who is Russian, had to resign as a CEO. And it seems that it's escalating one step further, where he has to divest from the company so that the company can go public. The problem is this guy owns most of the IP, actually brought most of the IP to the company. So if you have to get rid of people like that, when you do dual use, and that's the point of the discussion, the first part of the question, which goes to Augustin, when you have this space company which have voluntarily or not embedded in them a dual use possibility, and therefore a national security dimension, of course, it makes the whole story a bit more complicated. So what's your take on this, Augustin, since you're very specialized into these dual use companies with ACE?
Yes, indeed. And sorry, it's a key question, because dual use is seen by most investors as a risk. We see it also as a clear opportunity in building a company and creating value. Because at first, when we develop a technology and we sell it to military applications, you have this high level of specs that military applications require. So you can build a really strong product, a really strong service that you can then sell to civilian and to B2B and to larger enterprise. So we see this as an opportunity, but obviously there is this strong risk of capping. Basically, when you have clients that are governments, that are agencies, that are armed forces, you clearly have a big problem when you want to liquidate your investment, and you limit the number of acquirers, you limit the number of potential parties that could acquire your asset, and hence capping the exact value creation you wanted to add to the business by selling to the military or to armed forces. So to alleviate that, and we at ACE, we have this strong stance of developing links with first government and agencies. So we have ties, although not capitalistic, but we have ties and agreements with agencies. We talk to them regularly, and we diffuse tensions that happened when we sold Centrio, so an industrial IoT software, cybersecurity software company, to Cisco. We have companies selling to agencies and to large enterprise alike. So we develop links with the exact ideal buyers for these companies by having them as investors in our fund. So we can, once they are in the portfolio, be known and particularly well known by these European strategic buyers. And make sure that they completely understand the value of these companies. And finally, when we see capping value at exit, we also try to develop links with US buyers. And we at ACE, we try to act as gateways of US buyers into the European cybersecurity landscape, and make sure that the transaction can go through. Again, Centrio case, Cisco acquiring Centrio was part of our whole strategy of diffusing tensions, making companies known, and also making sure that US buyers are not seen as potential threats for the business and for the existing government clients.
Thank you, Augustin. Another second part of the my second question on this theme, of course, is SPACs in general. We see SPACs coming all over the place in the financial markets now. To me, it's a very interesting setup for at least the promoters. But SPACs is also hitting space. We've seen SPACs in the launcher domain with Vector. We've seen SPAC with satellites with Spire and the one I just mentioned. So I mean, Matt, at the beginning you mentioned that the founders we've been working with are much younger than you are, but you also are much younger than I am. So at my age, I remember in the 80s something called junk bonds. And Michael Blinken being the king of junk bonds until 10 years later, at the end of the 80s and the early 90s, he ended in jail because the whole thing turned into a scam. Drexel, Burnham, Lambert, the bank was badly hit. So you, to all of you, what's your take on SPACs and what could be the impact of SPACs on space?
I'm going to start and strike an optimistic note. SPACs is materially accelerating the inflow of capital into the space economy. Like, we're just building out the space economy much faster than we would have previously expected. I mean, I think just in the last few months, we have 6 announced space SPACs, each one like on the order of $300 to $400 million, right? So you're talking about $2 billion of capital. If the companies had to raise that in the private markets, that probably would have taken a materially longer time. Like you're alluding to, Jose, there's obviously always the danger of excess, and we're probably going to see excesses. Maybe we're already seeing excesses. But I think that comes with the territory, and that's, you know, the investors just have to be careful when they invest in these things. But I think for the space economy, this is a good thing.
Yeah.
Another opinion?
No. I mean, honestly, I agree with that. I mean, is there a risk around SPACs? Yes, of course, there is a risk with public market, because you know that public markets are driven by the company itself listed, but by macroeconomics. So this is something the former venture capitalists or private investors nor the CEO do have a hands-on. You cannot compete against the relationship between China and the US. But you know, this will have an impact for the stock market at large, therefore an impact into the stock prices. So this is something you cannot master. So it's a different world. The management team need to change the way they behave, the way they talk, the way they share their thoughts, because when you're a listed company, you are in a highly regulated environment, but this is not bad or right. It's just a different environment. So companies got to be ready to face this new environment. Then what's very, very good for the startup is raising $500 million to develop your company. This is just a great opportunity. And as mentioned by Raphael, to do that by private venture capitalists, it takes a bit more time. Then the risk is what? The risk is when you raise, let's say, 300 or $500 million, you got to make sure that this is the right amount to take you up to profitability, because next rounds are much more tricky to raise. Obviously, it's still possible, but it's a very different game. You cannot say, I'm at Series C, I'll be profitable in a year and a half or 2 years, let's go for a D round and I'll make that private and then I can go up to another one. In a public market, the game is very different. But if private startups with limited revenue want to raise $300 million to finance its product roadmap, it will be much more tricky in the private world, because people and venture capitalists will say, like they used to say, we need to go for tranches. And this is the point of having rounds, to increase the check size, increase the valuation, reduce the risk. I mean, this is the regular venture capitalist way of funding companies. So to me, it's overall for space and other tech areas, a boost that will help startups and that will accelerate the development of those technologies. But do I see risk? Yes, I do. But this is part of what we do.
Yeah, okay. Well, thank you. Just to allow me, if you allow me to be a bit provocative, as I said in my introduction, getting VC funding in space or getting private equity in space is really challenging if there's no, I would say, co-investment from governments or national security organizations. So when it becomes difficult to get private equity and you go for public funding and suddenly money flows, care should be applied. But I'll let it rest here and maybe turn to two very technical questions to finish the panel. Number one, quantum. We're entering the quantum era. It means a number of things. So what's going to be the impact or what's going to be the contribution of quantum in space, to space, from space? Matt, I know you had some ideas about that, but I'm sure you're not the only one.
Yeah. So if you want me to start on that one first, quantum will very quickly move out of the lab to the real world. I'm convinced about that. So this is quantum machine, quantum computers, and quantum capabilities, and the various application of quantum physics. So first point, this is just great because it will offer opportunities to solve problems that were not possible to be solved yesterday. I'm thinking, optimization, managing a fleet of LEO satellites, I mean, plenty of very, very good stuff. But it comes with another angle, which is a threat. All the encryption and the security techniques we are discussing since day one are based on RSA technologies. And this RSA will not be solid for long in front of just a basic quantum computers. Bottom line, we need to think about the post-quantum cybersec environment. So we got techniques around HSM. We do have post-quantum crypto with algorithm that will be certificate in 1, 2, 3, 5 years, I don't know, by the NIST and other organizations. I get that other techniques such as homomorphic encryptions, not ready today, could overcome some of those challenges. But basically, as it comes with a great solution, to solve problems, it will come as well with bigger risk on the cyber side. And I will just pin a last element, and then happy to get your views, is that quantum physics can bring tech disruption on some elements. I'm thinking here QKD, the quantum key distributions, based on quantum physics, that could offer, thanks to space and optical communication, very secured way of communicating data, relying on those quantum physics elements. So quantum, to me, will take the world in a new era, post-CPU, GPU, in, I don't know, 2, 3, 4, 5 years, with great stuff, new risks, and new solutions. So as a venture capitalist, carefully looking at those quantum physics technology, because it will open great opportunities for investment, for startups, and for future technologies.
Thank you, Matt.
Maybe, José, adding to this, I think I would draw, first, post-quantum cryptography is a problem of today. So I concur with Mathieu. Some government agencies are collecting encrypted data, not knowing what to do with it today, but just betting that once they have quantum capabilities available, they will be able to access it. So it's a reality of today. Now, the quantum adoption, I would draw a parallel with artificial intelligence. There will be very, very, very few people who can handle it at the start. This is a complete different environment, and you've seen it through your career, José. Building enough capabilities, as we've seen in AI, to understand not only how to design algorithm, but then how to deploy the algorithm and then match it with use cases or business requirement, has proven much more difficult than was anticipated with the hype. And I believe quantum is an order of magnitude above AI, and we have very limited resources worldwide, added to the fact that today studies show that we are already short of classical cybersecurity resources worldwide. So if you combine the two, that will slow down the adoption. But then, of course, for the people having the means and the resources, these become an incredible threat. So, but the larger scale is a challenge, in my view, because of the resources.
Yeah. Threat and an opportunity with quantum key distribution from space, because it turns out that distributing quantum keys in free space, and we're back to the free space optics potential, it works much better in free space than in fiber. So that's where really there's a potential, both between Earth and space and point to point on Earth. And finally, we only have 3 minutes left. Raphael, let me challenge you on new ideas, completely crazy ideas, which are circulating. And actually, the question goes to all of you. Data centers in space, storing data in space rather than in big data centers, which have a huge impact on the environment on Earth, maybe less impact on the environment in space. What are the ideas? What's the appetite of investors for this, and what's your take, Raphael?
Oh, well, that falls squarely into what I'd call the offensive part of, you know, looking at cybersecurity in space. So we love that. You mentioned data centers in space. So unfortunately, I didn't have a chance to watch the presentation, but I think Ohad von Lightloop was presenting at a conference. So I think that's a very interesting concept, right? Of data storage in space using a number of satellites and an optical inter-satellite links. So Lightloop is one example. There's a cloud constellation space belt, which I think is more or less trying to do the same thing. I think that kind of stuff is very exciting. And again, there's various ways of getting investment exposures through these companies. These companies also then need specialized hardware, which we can also invest in. So I think that's a very interesting thing we're looking at. We already mentioned the quantum key distribution. That's certainly something we're looking at. things like storing your crypto keys in space. You know, that's something we're looking at. Anything that's related to next gen GNSS systems. So, you know, GNSS systems which are, you know, much more resistant to jamming, which are not spoofable, which are more accurate, which are more responsive. That's something we're looking at. Yeah, just a few examples off the top of my head.
Any others?
Yeah, well, to add to that, and in part it's more anecdotally, but in some of the discussions we've had with financial institutions, just the sheer opportunity to not have your data on the ground when you move from December 31st to January 1st is worth hundreds of millions of dollars to some of these institutions. So data warehousing in space, just by these companies alone, will just pay for itself. And, you know, I say anecdotally, but actually this is a very real opportunity for these folks, just to see, just to illustrate how some of the opportunities that are out there, that while we're talking about security, this, that, and the other, which is extremely important, we just run into more and more applications and opportunities as part of bringing data communication, data warehousing into space.
Thanks. Any other take on this?
I mean, what the last thing I could add is that today we've got, 5 billion devices connected through space-based infrastructure. When you look at the various numbers, some people start to say 30 billion IoT devices connected through space. And then all what we're dealing with in our private life, cars, mobility, phones based on navigation, observation, 50% of the data we are looking at to monitor climate are acquired by space. So bottom line, all the infrastructure you will need, starting from launchers, then to satellite with all the building blocks, propulsion, payloads, communication, etc., down to ground station, plus all what you do with that, services, AI, I mean, all that will grow. So as investors, I get that 10 years ago or 15 years ago, space-based matters were very much perceived as government stories. I think it's not the case anymore at all. So obviously governments are part of the game, but they are not the only players anymore. So as investors, I agree with you what you said at the beginning, José, it's expensive, it takes time to generate your first dollars. But I think that those two barriers are lowering down, and more VCs that used to be in the traditional VC landscape will look at space, and particularly are looking at space for investment, because they believe that making a return space-based is much more probable today versus what it was a few years ago. So it's not a hype. I think it's very much here to stay for long, because this is part of the daily life of everybody on Earth.
Thank you, Matt. Just a last note on this data centers in space. What I find really fascinating is the idea that and again, it's linked to free space optics, the fact that we will be storing data not in warehouses in space, but actually in transit. And the data will actually be stored in the photons, which are traveling constantly from satellites to satellites. To me, this is a fascinating idea. Any concluding remarks, all of you, who wants to start? Now, Matt has already given his. Patrick, any concluding remarks?
No, it will be no news. So what you described to us is next generation serverless infrastructure. So I love it. All for it.
Ronald?
Sorry, I was on mute. No, thank you. I really appreciated this opportunity, and I've learned a lot during this conference. But again, I want to stress that security, whether it be you know, super duper quantum or more regulatory straightforward, it ultimately is a means to an end, and there are you know, other ways to secure data, particularly if it's flowing from one place to another. I offer topology as one of them, and there's more of them. So as long as we keep an open mind as to what makes sense and what does not, then I think we still got some good ways to go from an investment perspective with companies, you know, picking that up and making the most of that, and then mostly on the offensive side of things, where It is about helping companies communicate more securely through what space has to offer. So this is very, very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you, Ronald. Augustin?
Yes, definitely. Data storage in space is making me dream of a place where you cannot burn your data. The last story with OVH is something excruciating for the European landscape. And having since nothing burns really in space, having data storage in space would be great.
Thanks, Raphael. The final word.
Yeah, I think pretty much what the others said, and I reiterate, I would encourage people, especially the ones who are maybe from the cybersecurity community and not yet in the space community, to be open-minded and look at space as a solution for some of these problems.
Thank you, Raphael. Thank you all. Excellent discussion. I had fun, which is a sign that there was plenty of new ideas. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. Thanks a lot. Thanks to the audience, and look forward to more discussion on that.
José, I don't know if you can hear me from Davos.
Yes, I hear you, Mathieu.
I don't know if you guys have one last question from the chat about the KPIs, the key performance indicators about cybersecurity for space companies. How can we measure that?
Okay, I'm sorry. We were high in space and quantum and everything, and now we're down back to KPIs.
Yes, I was saying there is a question in the chat about how to measure the performance of sort of a KPI. Patrick Nicolet mentioned about 10% of the IT budget should be dedicated to space. Is there any other way to quantify, to measure cybersecurity for a space company?
First, given the complexity and of the system that goes from ground to space, you can use the usual KPIs you have for existing corporations. Then you will have a technical requirement that were discussed that are specific to space that you will have to include. But I think frameworks are existing for the enterprise, so I would start there.
And from the financial perspective, besides the rule of thumb about 10% of the IT budget, is there any other indicators?
Obviously, not much. No obvious response to this question, Mathieu. Sorry, Florent. It came from Florent Rizzo. Sorry about that.
All right. Then thanks to all the panelists. I don't know if they're still here, if they can still hear us, but thank you all. I was listening religiously to the discussion. I thought it was very interesting to have this angle of investors. Thank you, José, for moderating.
You're welcome. It was a pleasure.
And maybe since this is the last panel, this is the end of the event. To wrap up, José, you were here on day one. You're finishing on day three. What is your what are the key takeaways for you as AP Swiss, as Altin? What will you take home about this CYSAT 2021?
Well. I will, I'm really now strong with the impression that Switzerland is becoming a real space nation, if I may call it like that. If you remember, in December 2019, which is just a bit more than a year away, ESA launched TEOPS, which actually is the first Swiss satellite. So it's a satellite which will be investigating the atmosphere of exoplanets. And it's something which had been driven and engineered to a large extent by Switzerland. And after that, and around that, over the last 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, we've seen growing space sector in space in Switzerland. RUAG now is developing structures for platforms for OneWeb, the whole constellation. Currently, they're building a platform for METOP, the major, one of the biggest space programs for meteorological observation for the European Meteorological Organization. ClearSpace, we've heard ClearSpace earlier today. A Swiss company, a Swiss startup actually, has been tasked by ESA to develop the first European mission to remove debris from space. Swiss to 12, another Swiss company, which is doing 3D printing of antennas and waveguides and a number of other elements of in RF technology in satellites. They're working with OneWeb, they're working with Thales, they're working with the largest players in space. Astrocast, we've also seen Astrocast. Astrocast will become the first global telecom operator in Switzerland, and it's going to be probably the leader in IoT, global IoT from space. CYSEC will provide cybersecurity. Obviously, CYSEC is taking the lead in providing cybersecurity for distributed systems and the space systems. And there are plenty of small service companies which are using space infrastructure to develop a service on Earth. And these companies have been supported by AP Swiss, the ESA Business Applications Program. There's GeoSatis, which has this electronic bracelet for monitoring prisoners, Gamaya, which is doing precision farming, RVM, tracking containers, DotPhoton, processing images and doing lossless compression. And of course, there's the ESA BIC Switzerland, one of the business incubating centers operated by ESA throughout Europe. ESA BIC in Switzerland is one of the most active BICs in Europe. We're taking 10 startups every year. So after 5 years of operation, it's 50 new startups which have been incubated in the ESA BIC. And ESA BIC just signed another contract for 5 years with ESA, which means that it's going to be another 50 startups incubated in the future. So we have a really big ecosystem which is building up in Switzerland, and we begin to have champions in a number of areas which are very, very, very powerful. And it's been a pleasure to have so many of them participating to CYSAT 21. So first impression I take from CYSAT 21 is the fact that I'm impressed by the level of advancement of the Swiss space activity.
Thank you, José. It was indeed a Swiss initiative, CYSAC, especially myself. We were deeply involved and led the efforts. We had the support of ESA, AP Swiss, and a number of sponsors that I mentioned during the event. Honestly, the journey has been quite unbelievable. We had this initial idea, José, to organize the first event in Europe about cybersecurity for space. And here we are, more than 200 participants to the event. I was blown away to see the enthusiasm about the event that really showed that cybersecurity and space are indeed like at the heart of the discussions, new space and all these promising technologies. So let's keep the discussion open. We obviously want to commit to sign up for next year. How do you see, José, CYSAT 2022? Let's dream. Tease us about the next year's event.
Well, before jumping into CYSAT 2022, emphasizing what you just said, CYSAT 21 in Davos was a success. We had more than 200 participants. It's important to restate it. We had 6 panels, 50 speakers. We had presentations from hackers, of course, ethical ones. We had presentations from startups. We also had established players. We had established players in space. We had Airbus, we had Telesat. We had also And that was very important to me. We had the big players of the cloud and IT and digital economy, like IBM. We had Microsoft, IBM, the two of them already make the show, and McAfee and several others. So you're right, Mathieu, this was an incredible success. And you build on success. And the decision is that we're going to go for CYSAT 22 again in Davos, hopefully together. And there we'll try and organize more events. We, of course, we'll put up a hacking competition. We'll see how to organize a competition of hackers to hack a satellite virtually and many other possibilities. Of course, if we have the chance of actually physically gathering in Davos next year, there's plenty with that we can consider. But before closing and before calling for CYSAT 22 in Davos, let me first thank all the sponsors. Of course, the first of them is ESA, the European Space Agency, through AP Swiss, which is sponsored by ESA. ESA has been the key sponsor of this conference. The European GNSS Agency, GSA, has been another important sponsor. Leaf Space, which is providing operation services for companies, and Space Innovation, which made a presentation earlier this afternoon. Let me also thank the organizers or the co-organizers, and the CISEC, which did a great job, and Mathieu, you and Patrick Trinkler, you've been fantastic partners to organize this conference, and of course AP Swiss and ESA Big Switzerland, which also contributed to this event. And finally, allow me to thank the organizing team, and particularly of course Constant Blanc. He made a terrific job to make this conference online efficient. We had a few hiccups at the beginning, but it was cleaned, and the operations over the 3 years have been perfect, and a demonstration of the capabilities of good operations. So I think it was a great event. The content was impressive, incredibly informative. The forum was fun, and it really illustrates the momentum we have in Switzerland. So the only conclusion I can make here is welcome to CYSAT 22 in Davos, in Switzerland.
Thank you. Thank you, José. I think that's a great conclusion. Thanks again to the team. They're just behind the camera here wearing their masks. Thanks again. It's been a great pleasure to be your host. As a good startup, we'll be asking for feedback. We want to make sure that this MVP, this product, CYSAT 2021, did a good job at fulfilling some of your needs, but we want to hear more about how we can improve for next year. Do you have any more topics you want us to address? Do you want to speak? You want to sponsor? Get involved. It's important to talk security and space. Get in touch with us, with me at CYSEC. We'll be getting ready for CYSAT 2022. Thank you. Thank you, José. Great pleasure. Okay. Thanks again. Thank you to all the team. And see you at CYSAT 2022 next year. Bye-bye.